Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
It's wonderful to be with you this morning. In our Gospel today, we hear the kingdom of God compared to a wedding banquet. And although COVID doesn't quite allow such things to happen these days, it's so great to be gathered in whatever way we can, both physically and also those who will be viewing this online. Kevin has asked me to say that this service is being videoed, it is being recorded, and so if you feel more comfortable not being videoed, if you could tap him on the shoulder and let him know, that would be much appreciated. My name is Rowena Paling. I'm the Vice Dean and Canon Missioner at Blackburn Cathedral. Always good to be out and about in the diocese, and it's lovely to be with you this morning. Our worship continues with some music.
Let it
name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. Jesus says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand. So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. Lord God,
we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew our right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
May the Father of all mercies cleanse you from your sin and restore you in his image to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed is the Lord.
For he has heard the voice of our prayer.
Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy.
And in our song we praise our God.
Blessed be you, Lord our God, creator and redeemer of all. To you be glory and praise forever. From the waters of chaos you drew forth the world, and in your great love fashioned us in your image. Now through the deep waters of death, you have brought your people to new birth by raising your Son to life in triumph. May Christ your light ever dawn in our hearts as we offer you our sacrifice of thanks and praise. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God.
The night is past, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever.
Amen.
And so we begin our engagement with the scriptures with some verses from Psalm 106. Alleluia, give thanks to the Lord, for he is gracious, for his faithfulness endures forever. Who can express the mighty acts of the Lord, or show forth all his praise? Blessed are those who observe what is right, and always do what is just. Remember me, O Lord, in the favour you bear for your people. Visit me in the day of your salvation, that I may see the prosperity of your chosen, and rejoice in the gladness of your people, and exult with your inheritance. We have sinned like our forebears. We have done wrong and dealt wickedly. They made a calf at Horeb and worshipped the molten image. Thus they exchanged their glory for the image of an ox that feeds on hay. They forgot God, their Saviour, who had done such great things in Egypt, wonderful deeds in the land of Ham, and fearful things at the Red Sea. So he would have destroyed them, had not Moses, his chosen, stood before him in the breach, to turn away his wrath from consuming them. Glory to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Let's read in 2 Kings, chapter 4, beginning at verse 1. So then, brothers, how did you look to me, and how I miss you? How happy you may be, and how proud I am of you. This then, dear brothers, is how you should stand firm in the life of the Lord. A week here, as in duty, kept peace, I beg you, try to bring the sisters in the Lord. And you too, my faithful father, I want you to help these women, for they have worked hard with me to spread the gospel together in heaven, and all my other fellow workers, whose names are in the gospel of the living.
May we always be joyful in your union with the Lord. I say it again, rejoice. Show a gentle attitude towards everyone. The Lord is coming soon. Don't worry about sleeping, but in all your prayers, ask God for what you need, always asking Him with a thankful heart. And God's peace, which is far beyond human understanding, will keep your hearts and minds safe in union with Christ Jesus. In conclusion, my brothers, fill your minds with those things that are good and that deserve praise. Things that are true, noble, right, pure, lovely, and honourable. Put into practice what you learnt and received from me, both from my words and from my actions, and the God who gives us peace will be with you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Second reading is taken from the Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 22, the parable of the wedding feast. Jesus again used parables in talking to the people. The kingdom of heaven is like this. Once there was a king who prepared a wedding feast for his son. He sent his servant to tell the invited guests come to the feast, but they did not want to come. So he sent other servants with this message for the guests. My feast is ready now. My bullocks and prized calves have been butchered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast. But the invited guests paid no attention and went about their business. One went to his farm, another to his shop. My lovers grabbed the servants, beat them, and killed them. The king was very angry, so he sent his soldiers who killed those murderers and burnt down their city. Then he called his servants and said to them, my wedding feast is ready, but the people I invited did not deserve it. Now go to the main streets and invite to the feast as many people as you find. So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, good and bad alike. And the wedding hall was filled with people. The king went in to look at the guests and saw a man who was not wearing wedding clothes. Friend, how did you get in here without wedding clothes? The king asked him. The man said nothing. Then the king told the servants, tie him up hand and foot and throw him outside in the park. There he will cry and grind. Jesus concluded, many are invited, but few are chosen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
If you
are
able to do so, would you please stand and be joined together for words of benediction? Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who has come to his people and set them free.
Save.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Please do be seated. Well, it's really good to be back. Last time I was here was about 18 months ago, when I brought some candidates from the cathedral for confirmation. It was a really joyous day, and I remember huge quantities of cake in the hall just over the road. A real party atmosphere. It's difficult, isn't it, now to remember when we were able to gather like that. In exactly the same way, our parable of the wedding feast feels rather strange as an illustration. It's definitely relating to pre-COVID times. And I'm sure that just like us down the road, you must have had wedding couples here cancel or postpone. But for good or for ill, today's gospel does focus on a party, on a feast. And I'm going to tell you about a sermon which I once heard preached about this passage. And I want you to see if you can spot the fatal flaw in it. So there we were in church with somebody in the pulpit and they were preaching on this passage, or possibly, to be fair to them, on Luke's version of the same story. In Luke, we have this. All alike, the people began to make excuses. The first said, "I have bought a piece of land, and I must go and see it. Please accept my apologies." Another said, "I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I'm going to try them out. Please accept my apologies." Another said, "I've just been married, and therefore I cannot come." Obviously, today's passage is very similar, but typically of Matthew rather more gruesome. Matthew says they would not come. They made light of it and went away. The rest seized the slaves and killed them. So the preacher of that sermon really focused on the idea that those who were invited to the feast made excuses. They all claimed to be washing their hair, or the first century equivalent of that. And just as they made their excuses, so too do we make excuses not to spend time with God, not to take up his invitation, not to come to church. I wonder if you've noticed what the fatal flaw in that line of reasoning is. Is it right to berate people not to take up God's invitation and not to come to church when in fact you're preaching to people who have? Now, of course, we can all beat ourselves up, can't we, and say yes, sometimes we would, frankly, rather stay in bed than come out on a chilly morning. Or perhaps even that yes, we do come to church regularly, but sometimes our heart is just not in it. And incidentally, that's what the man without the wedding garment expresses. Sometimes we find that a really difficult story to engage with. It seems as if it might be exclusive. It seems as if he might be somebody who can't afford nice clothes or a wedding garment, a Sunday vest. But in fact, what he represents is somebody who goes through the motions, but can't actually be bothered to engage properly, and who isn't obedient to God's will or to following the teachings of Jesus. For goodness sake, let's give ourselves a break and not beat ourselves up, at least today. Let's focus not on the invitees who made their excuses, but instead on the slaves, the servants who invited them. Because that gives us a different challenge. Yes, there are plenty of people who don't respond to God's call or invitation. church or that they should find out more about Jesus Christ. It's up to us. It's our responsibility to tell them why. Now, some of you may have been coming to church all your life, and I won't guess how many years that might have been for you as individuals. But others of you may remember the first time you crossed the threshold, or the first time you ever encountered Christianity. If you can remember what that felt like, just think about it for a moment. For most people, it's not the case that they hate or despise Christianity, that they seize and kill those who invite them. For most people, it's simply that they don't really know who Jesus is or what following him is all about. And if you don't know what it is that you're being invited to, then of course you're not very likely to say yes. You're much more likely to screw up the invitation and throw it in the bin, or, well, hopefully in the recycling. So again, we might ask, what are we going to do about that? Well, I can't give you an answer because I don't know your context well enough. But you know it. You will know what you are doing already as individuals and as a church community to proclaim the gospel, to engage with people, to explain God's invitation to them. And you'll also know what more you could be doing. There are so many different ways of proclaiming the gospel, but the absolute key is communicating in a way which connects. That might be through your worship, both physically and online. It can also be about specific opportunities for which you offer to help people to learn more about the Christian faith. And of course, it can also be in the acts of service which you perform day by day for people who are in need, witnessing by doing so to Jesus Christ. All of those are hugely important for communicating God's invitation and its significance to the world. But if that's what we are being asked to do, then I suppose the next question is, who is going to do it? Which of us are going to be the ones who go out in the streets and invite others to join us? Well, when Paul writes to the Christians at Philippi, as we heard read to us earlier, he makes special mention of three individuals: Euodia, Syntyche, and Clement. Now, those aren't big name apostles, other than that their names are physically quite big with a lot of syllables, and perhaps you've never heard of any of them before. But clearly, they are all people who have worked with Paul. He says that they've struggled beside him in proclaiming the gospel. And what I think is particularly interesting about these three is that two of them, Euodia and Syntyche, both have female names. So for all the reputation that Paul has for being, let's be honest, a bit of a misogynist, throughout his letters we actually see genuine diversity in his community and genuine diversity amongst those who take on responsibilities and lead their communities. These leaders, these ones who are making invitations, who are proclaiming the gospel, include both women and men, people of Greek heritage and people of Jewish heritage. And we can adopt that same model here. If we are going to communicate the absolute joy and importance of our faith with people who've never really encountered it before, and who may well not even have a set of words to describe experience such as prayer or spiritual longing, which perhaps we take for granted, then each one of us is going to need to get across God's invitation to the people with whom we most naturally connect. And we're going to need to do that with confidence and with joy. Just as those earliest Christian communities needed men and women, young and old, proclaiming the gospel through their words and actions, do we. It's exactly the same for us today. So whoever you are, and whether you've been coming here for years and years and years, or whether only recently, whatever your background, whatever your age or your gender, we all need to be like those servants in the parable and invite others to join God's feast. Because that, at least, is a celebration which not even a pandemic can stop. As Paul says, rejoice in the Lord always. Let us lay down our own agendas and seek the face of God and His will for the church and for the world. We pray for all who are seeking God and for the nurturing process in this parish. We pray for the opportunities to share God's love and draw others to meet Him. Today, we give thanks for Rowena as she leads our worship. And we pray for God's blessing on Janet and everyone who is supporting and helping us to maintain and develop our witness at St. Peter's as we embrace this time of vacancy. Help us to support each other, whether here, together, in public worship, or through contact with those who are unable to join us in church, as we hold them in our thoughts and prayers, and in your love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all who are fighting against evil, for goodness, truth, and justice, both those who make the world news and those whose battles are known only to God. We pray for our country and its leaders, that this nation may seek God. Father God, we know that wherever there is trouble in the world, resulting from natural disasters, from man's inhumanity to man, and from this current pandemic, you are beside us, our unseen companion on God's journey. Be with the emergency services, the aid agencies, the charities and the health workers who work tirelessly with little heed of the risks they are taking. May we never succumb to compassion fatigue, as the familiar images appear daily in the press or on television.
We know the transformative power our faith can bring about in our daily lives. We pray that our lights may shine in the current darkness and our witness lead others to seek out a different way of life, securing the knowledge that you are a friend in need and that your love never fails. Your Son Jesus Christ ministered to the sick and the dying. Comfort and heal all who suffer at this time, in body, mind, or spirit, that they and those who care for them may experience the power of your love and peace, which passes all understanding. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray for those whose earthly life has come to an end, and for those who mourn their going. Today, we pray for the repose of the souls of Kathleen Noblet, whose funeral took place on Thursday, and for Bill Buckley, who died on Thursday. May the dead rest in the peace and joy of heaven through the mercy of God. At this time, when we are bombarded by numbers of those who have died, help us to remember that even as the meanest sparrow, each one is known to you and loved by you. Comfort all who are bereaved at a time when the usual grieving process